subscribe button to subscribe to our channel. Press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
Welcome to Kautilya Careers. Today we are going to see about the daily editorial analysis of 3rd January from the Hindu. The topics that we are going to discuss today are as follows. Firstly, deterrence or danger. In this we are going to see whether having a nuclear triad, that is the ability of the country to launch nuclear missiles from ground, from air or from oceans, whether it can increase the deterrence or it might lead to more dangerous situations in the international security arena. Deterrence means making it fearful for the enemy to start an attack against us. If we have nuclear weapon, ultimately there is no doubt the enemies are going to fear, because if nuclear weapons are utilized, then ultimately it might cause mass casualties upon the countries on which these weapons are used against. In this we are going to see the nuclear triad capability developed by India and the recently launched the submarine launch vehicle, that is submarine which has the capability to also launch missiles carrying nuclear warhead upon them. Next, powering South Asian integration. So firstly, the South Asian countries, the integration level between these countries is very low because the economic engagement or interconnectivity, people-to-people connectivity or other kind of aspects between these countries are lower. But recently, the rules that have been given by the Ministry of Power of India has the capability to increase the trading of the electricity between these countries. In this, we are going to see what kind of benefits that it is going to bring and that can be enjoyed by the countries which has surplus power production capabilities. Next, lessons from Kerala. In this we are going to see how Kerala is trying to improve the public health facilities, especially by strengthening the primary healthcare centers. Next, all along the coastlines, in this we are going to see the recent relaxation in terms of pursuing any construction related activities near the coastal areas. And that relaxation might have certain positive impacts upon the economy, but we can also find out the drawbacks that might cause in the future or in the present as well. Next, GST shortfall. So this hasty implementation of GST and the inability to understand what might be the proper taxes that are better to be imposed upon the goods, we are again and again witnessing the shortfall or lowering of the collection of the GST proceeds that ultimately impacts the revenue of the government, and also the burden upon the government is going to increase. Especially this year before the election, it will significantly impact upon the fiscal stability or fiscal balance, given the way in which government is trying to spend to boost the growth in our economy. Next, breaking the stranglehold. This is regarding the kind of prevalence of bonded labor we are witnessing still in our country. In this, we are going to check out the details of the bonded labor that is being carried out and the measures that are to be taken for reduction of these kinds of practices in our country. Next, India achieved its nuclear triad as recently Arihant submarine was launched, and this is carrying trials have already been completed and presently it is plying upon the ocean. Next, this acts as a deterrence because if the enemy might neutralize the capability of a country to launch missile either through the ground or from the air, then ultimately we can utilize this nuclear capability being launched through the oceans because these submarines are not properly detectable to the enemy. Thus, even if the targets are destroyed or even if the countries have utilized its nuclear capability to destroy the population of our country, we can still retaliate by utilization of the submarines which has the capability to launch the nuclear missiles against our enemy country. So this is the reason why nuclear triad was first pursued by the countries of the USSR as well as the United States of America. But the thing is, the usual targets of the nuclear weapons are not the areas where the nuclear weapons are stored in other countries, but targeting the mass population that resides in the countries. Thus, despite the targeting of the population, the particular country might still hold the nuclear weapons that can be launched either through the land or through the air version. So, the requirement of the nuclear weapons to be launched from the ocean is not a necessary thing, as told or claimed by this article. And the other thing is, before the companies engage, the countries engage in the nuclear warfare, they are going to engage in various kinds of negotiations. As can be seen during the time of war between India and Pakistan in the year 1998. And during these kinds of negotiations, United Nations Security Council is also going to intervene so that peace can be brought out between the countries which holds the nuclear weapons. Next, the nuclear weapon triad being developed by India and its consequences between the security arrangement between India and Pakistan, or the security environment between India and Pakistan. Firstly, Pakistan has presently no nuclear doctrine which guides the way in which it is going to use its nuclear weapon. But it has said on quite a few occasions that it is going to use its nuclear weapons if it is compelled to do so. For example, if we are going to involve in any conventional war against Pakistan, and if we are able to defeat that enemy, then Pakistan might use the nuclear weapon to destroy India. And Pakistan claims that it has tactical nuclear weapons too. For example, if we are going to engage in any kind of conventional warfare activity between India and Pakistan, then Pakistan will not only target the major parts of India, but also the army which is fighting for our defense. Tactical weapons are nothing but the weapons that can be launched to the nearer targets. Thus, in the bordering regions, the tactical nuclear weapons might be utilized to neutralize our defense forces. Next, India has no first use policy doctrine. That is, India is not going to utilize its nuclear weapons capability unless it is provoked or unless it is targeted by other countries, nuclear weapons or biological weapons, etc. And it said that it is going to utilize it only for retaliatory measure, as I already explained you. China too has similar policy. Next, Pakistan is on the course to build its naval variant as well. This ultimately might lead to a nuclear war race between India and Pakistan to strengthen the nuclear capabilities of both the countries. Thus, this has already seen in the history between US and USSR that ultimately impacts the cost as well as the economic scenario, given both these countries are still developing. Once they do not have enough revenues to fund these kinds of activities, this ultimately deprives the population of the precious economic resources that are scarce in those countries. And next, the Powering South Asian Integration. The Ministry of Power has recently released rules that regulate the flow of electricity between the South Asian countries. The earlier concerns raised by the countries regarding the rules framed by Ministry of Power of India is that India said that it is only going to buy the power produced from the neighboring countries, from the companies which have significant Indian investment in them, or the companies which are owned by the relative governments, or by the governments from government of Nepal's public sector undertakings, etc. To restrict the Chinese control, India has brought out this measure, because if the liberalism is promoted in these kinds of electricity transactions, then ultimately China might seek to exploit the benefits of these kinds of engagement because of the capabilities of China. It might invest in these projects that involve in electricity generation, thus ultimately it might control the electricity market in India. Next, this excluded private power producers of Nepal as well. That is, as I already explained, the private producers of power of the adjacent countries or the neighboring countries are not allowed to transact the electricity between India and the adjacent countries, that is South Asian countries. This especially impacts the revenue generation capabilities of the Nepal and Bhutan because they have high capability to produce hydroelectric power. And it also limited the access to Indian electricity spot market to Bhutan. Bhutan was trying to exploit the capability to earn profits through tapping in the spot market through which it can sell the electricity generated in Bhutan. And Bangladesh also wished to buy power from the Nepal and other countries like Bhutan, given the scarcity of power in the Bangladesh. But India had much control as per the rules framed by India itself. Thus, these are the concerns raised by the South Asian countries regarding the rules framed by India. But the recent rules released by Ministry of Power of India have brought a sigh of relief. It has relaxed many of these restrictions. And the tripartite agreement to sell the power among the nations was also been shown in these rules. That is, if Bangladesh wants to buy power from Bhutan, it can buy through the India. It can buy directly from Bhutan. Bhutan gives electricity to our country and we in turn give the electricity to Bangladesh, through these kinds of channels, Bangladesh will be easily able to buy the power from the countries which have a surplus power. Next, these power exchanges between these countries will also stabilize the grid of India because we are trying to produce more electricity through renewable channels like solar power, wind power, etc. Because there are seasons where the wind power and solar power ability to generate electricity is lower. At those points of time, it is better to utilize these kinds of channels. We can stabilize the grid through continuous supply of electricity through the wires of our country. And this supply can be from the South Asian countries. So these facilities might ultimately improve the trading in terms of electricity. And this might act as a step towards engaging in more trade related activities that might strengthen the integration between South Asian countries. Next, lessons from the Kerala that are to be learnt. See, last year Astana declaration was made, which has reaffirmed the predecessor Almata declaration, which was done in the year 1978. These declarations are regarding strengthening the public health facilities by strengthening the primary healthcare centers. Primary healthcare is the first line of healthcare provided to the population, especially in terms of providing basic diagnostics or immunity facilities, vaccinations, etc. If primary health is provided in a proper manner, then the health expenditure of the population can be significantly reduced because primary health care has the capability to boost up the immunity systems of the population, as well as the ability to diagnose the disease earlier, as well as the ability to promote preventive health care. This is to strengthen the primary health care, as I already explained you. In the year 2016, Kerala has made attempts to redesign its primary care to commit to the Astana declaration. And this redesigning of the primary care facilities in the Kerala is to address the current as well as the future epidemiological situations that exist in that state. The Almata declaration says that its aim is to meet people's healthcare across life course through comprehensive preventive care, promotive care, curative care, rehabilitative services, and palliative cure. So it wants to provide comprehensive health policies that encompasses all these kinds of facilities. The Kerala experiment is that the Kerala experiment to promote efficient and proper primary health care. It has seen that the primary health care for 30,000 population that is presently followed in our country will not be suitable to provide all these facilities as claimed as per the Astana declaration. So presently it has been opening a primary healthcare center for every 5,000 population existing in that state. And it also found that the primary healthcare centers has a better capability to provide health facilities if it is giving cure to or care to 2,500 population. Next, this increase in the primary health centers require more personnels and also creates more demand. Thus, it might lead to increase in the cost of the drugs, consumables, equipments and space too, because we need to create or construct more bungalows to establish primary healthcare centers. Next, it requires large number of trained human resources, as I already explained you. And as it requires time to provide training to the graduates, Kerala has come up with a short-term course that provides various training facilities in terms of diabetes, hypertension, etc. Next, electronic data sharing between various levels of healthcare is a necessity, because we need to be able to update the health-related information of the patient that ultimately improves the ability to provide efficient and healthy care to the patient. Next, private involvement is also a necessity given the way in which private hospitals are providing health care in our country. Thus, by proper engagement of the private hospitals, we will be able to lessen the burden upon the government of India. Because presently, the government of India or government of the states, public health care centers do not have the capability to cater to the entire population of our country. So through this, we can understand the way in which we have to develop our healthcare systems to cater to the population. Next, all along the coastline. So coastal regulation zone restrictions have been recently relaxed by government. As per this, it wants to promote tourism and affordable housing in the coastal areas. Given the coastal areas are sensitive, that is why coastal regulation zones are created, wherein the construction related activities are permitted on the basis of various restrictions. And now most of the autonomy to allow any construction related activities have been given to the states. And in areas of the sensitive zone, central government retains the power to grant any kind of removal of restrictions to construct any kind of aspects. That might be for housing facilities or any kind of tourism promotion. Next, this will certainly increase the employment given the tourism potential, as well as grow local businesses through the tourism. But the issues regarding these kinds of restrictions being relaxed is that the commercial pressure on the fishermen might increase. And this increase in the pressure might lead to the vulnerability of fishermen. And this also might increase in the sea level. We are already witnessing the rise in sea level due to the climate change, and any kind of construction being taken place near the coastal zones might be impacted by this increase in the sea level. And the cyclonic impact, because especially in the coastal areas of our country which are witnessing tropical cyclones, and that too in terms of increase in number as well as intensity, this might have significant impact upon the constructions that are to be permitted against the change of rules that the government has recently released. Next, GST shortfalls. GST collection has declined once again. We are witnessing a trend of decline in the collection of the GST. Added to it, we have proposed a reduction for traders and small businesses to give them incentives to improve their economic aspects. This might further reduce the GST collection in the future too. And state GST collections as of now are uncertain. But as per the agreement that have been entered by various states to implement the GST, central government is obligated or has been mandated as per the law to compensate for the loss of revenue to the states for 5 years. And it couldn't boost revenue through other kind of avenues like collection of direct taxes and disinvestment proceeds, that is the backlog that presently government is witnessing due to the implementation of the GST cannot be compensated by these means, that ultimately impacts the revenue of the government as well. Next, government is planning for capital spending and various concessional measures, like for providing concessional interest loans to micro, small, medium enterprises, etc. These will certainly get hit if at all government is to pursue these kinds of measures that ultimately might impact upon the fiscal health of our country, thus leading to other kind of aspects like macroeconomic instability in the future that might also impact the foreign investments in our country. Next, the breaking the stranglehold. So in the December 22, in the last year, we have seen the bonded labor news, and various prominent leaders have also tweeted regarding the prevalence of this practice in our country. And last week, 52 trafficked were found, were rescued, that is, they were working in the ginger farm in the Karnataka. They have been rescued. So this shows the prevalence as well. Bonded Labor Abolition Act of the 1976 abolishes the practice of the bonded labor in the first place. But despite the regulation, we aren't able to enforce it properly. Next, Global Slavery Index of 2016 has said that India has 1.8 crore modern slaves. And International Labor Organization has estimated the bonded laborer present in our country in the year 2014 to be 1.17 crore. And no national survey has been compiled as of now to estimate the level of slavery or kind of bonded labor present in our country. We are still relying upon the international data, which we are not, agreeing with the international data, or we are, on the other hand, we are not compiling our data itself to count the number of bonded laborers that are working in our country as well. Next, the number of numbers relied upon, the present, our reliance upon the numbers of the bonded labor is on the basis of the relief and rehabilitation pursued by the state to rescue the population that are working as bonded laborers. Since 1975, 3.13 lakh of the bonded laborers have been rescued in our country. The reason for the prevalence of the bonded labor is lack of awareness among the bonded laborers regarding the right that they have been provided under these renewed act called the Bonded Labor Abolition Act. The other thing is they approach to the police in the rarest of the rare circumstances, especially they witness any kind of overt violence being committed against them by the owners of the bonded laborers. National Crime Records Bureau data showed that police are not providing proper numbers regarding the number of individuals working as bonded laborers. Between 2014 and 2016, close to 290 cases were registered in the police that showed only 1,338 victims. But if you count the numbers, within the six states, we have found 5,676 bonded laborers working. Thus, this shows a difference in the number shown by the police and the difference in number in actuality. Next, the dispersal of central funds. Only 20,000 rupees are granted to the rescued bonded laborer, and the rest of the money that is to be granted as per the Bonded Labor Abolition Act is to be given only if the individual who is accused is to be convicted of practicing the bonded labor practice. And only 32% of the cases have shown any kind of conviction in our country. Thus, conviction rates in terms of the Bonded Labor Abolition Act are still low. The individuals of certain backgrounds are compelled to practice this bonded labor activity. The socio-economic background is one of the reasons why many of the individuals are being exploited to involve in bonded labor activity. Socio-economic means they are poor socially as well as economically. And you can consider them to be Dalits and Adivasis because they are the most socio-economically weaker sections in our society. And they are promised of steady pay. And small and meager advanced loans are provided to them. Thus, they are being exploited in these kinds of rings. First, the government needs to conduct annual survey to estimate the amount of prevalence of bonded labor practice in our country so that we can promote any kind of preventive measures, and financial access to the vulnerable is to be provided, because due to lack of financial access, they are taking loans from other kinds of individuals and thus they are getting trapped into this bonded labor practice. Next, regulatory attention is to be made to track the trafficking as well as prohibit it, and the trafficking rings or other kind of rings are to be restricted severely through the regulatory environment, and we need to promote the protection to the bonded labor by providing proper money or other kind of rehabilitation facilities as well. So there ends today's daily editorial analysis, and for any further updates, please subscribe to our channel Kautilya Careers. Thank you.